Tonight is Rosh Chodesh Sivan. The topic is Ki'ish Echad V'Leiv Echad, of one man and one heart. Rashi says that B'nai Yisrael arrived at Har Sinai on Rosh Chodesh Sivan tonight. They were ready for Matan Torah. So Rashi says this Chaniya, this camping, was Ki'ish Echad V'Leiv Echad, was like one man with one heart. Aval Sh'ar Chaniyas, but every other time they camped in the Torah, there was a machlokes going on. So it sounds pretty good. Tonight, Rosh Chodesh Sivan is beautiful. Everybody was one, everybody felt good, we all felt together, we felt ready to accept the Torah. But as good as that may be, isn't that a bit scary? What kind of comment is that about the rest of the time? The rest of the time we're arguing, like only one day on Rosh Chodesh Sivan is the only time in anticipation of Matan Torah that we're able to be together. What about the rest of the time? An explanation is simple. There's nothing wrong with having an argument. Jews like to argue. In fact, arguing is our very backbone, the fabric of who we are. What would a Gemara be like if there was no possibility of arguing? Each person is meant to have his own opinion. We're not a melting pot where each person gives up of his own self. Every single individual is special in his own right, and we expect each person to express his or her own self. If that's the case, the question is really other way around. What does it mean that on Rosh Chodesh Sivan we all got to one entity? Does that mean we all gave up on who we are and what we are? Does that mean that every other time was the correct way, and on Rosh Chodesh Sivan we suddenly became one melting pot? What happened on Rosh Chodesh Sivan? What in fact happened was this. You see, yes, every single individual is supposed to have his or her own opinion. Every single Jew, every single person is special in his or her own right, yes. But once in a while, there's some space here for the ladies. Ladies dominate tonight. I'm fine. We have three spaces. The explanation is that on Rosh Chodesh Sivan, we were looking at, despite our differences, which are good, which are positive, we want to be different, we want to each have our own personality, we want to each be special. But despite our differences, as positive as they are, once in a while, as we accept the Torah, we have to each give up on that. And we have to work to discover one part of ourselves that's all one entity. Because you see, Jews have an element of chitzonius, of externality, and an element of pnimius, of internal. And even though in the external we may be different, and we all have to be different, but inside, kulanu ish echadanu. We're all one person, we're all one individual, we're all one entity. And that's what it means when the Gemara says that when they arrived at Rosh Chodesh Sivan, they arrived at Har Sinai, it said that Moshe Rabbeinu didn't tell them anything. And you ask the question, Moshe Rabbeinu is about to produce the Torah. They come to Har Sinai. They're about to get there. They've arrived at Har Sinai tonight. They're there. They're standing by Har Sinai. What do? He says, well, let's rest, because you guys might need some space to rest. What space to rest? We're about to receive the Torah. We're so anticipating. How can we begin to think about resting? Elamai, what does resting mean? It means they were on a journey. They were on a path. They were on a mission to be able to discover their inner soul, the deep side of us that makes us all one. Though we are different, though we each have our own particular derech, what Hashem demands of us, but inside we all have a pnimius, we all have one thing that makes us all one entity, one being. And it was a chulsha de'urcha, it was a lot of work to be able to reach that point. To be able to reach the point of le'amelu v'le'midi, which means he didn't tell them anything. He told them nothing. What he told them was to become nothing.
What he told them was to discover the nothingness, the deep side, which is inside of us, the ability to be nothing, the ability to be one with each other. So yes, on the one hand, we all are different, and that's what we celebrate all year round. But now, as we're heading towards Matan Torah, we're celebrating something different. The fact that inside, all of us belong to God, all of us are one with Hashem, and we're all one entity. And with that, I would like to introduce Rabbi Katz, but I want to share with Rabbi Katz one little nekuda over here. We have an institution over here, which is Mayan Yisroel, is a center for Hasidus, and one of our flagship shiurim is a shiur in Tanya, which is going on every single morning. It's actually amazing that the shiur is 8:45 a.m. till like 9:30, 9:40 a.m. And people are at least a minion standing at that time. And the shiur is all because of Rabbi Katz, who may not know about it. But here's what happened. There was someone over here who actually initiated the shiur. And he was hearing a shiur from Rabbi Katz. And he, not sure how that happened, but he wanted to find out some of the foundations of where that comes from. So I don't know if he asked Rabbi Katz or he found out. But he discovered that a lot has to do with Tanya. And so he made the request that we should begin a shiur Tanya. And as a result of that, I'm happy to inform you, Rabbi Katz, that's been going on for, I think, 5 years now, every single day, 5 days a week, which all your course that's been happening, we've been through it already twice. Well, again.
It's more than me.
All your course, Yashar Koyach. And just want at the same time mention that we have over here some other shiurim going on, which we have Rabbi Yosef Jacobson, a phenomenal shiur that he gives every Wednesday evening at 9 o'clock it begins. And Shavuos is going to be a break. And there's a lady shiur in Tanakh on Wednesday mornings at 10 a.m. If anyone wants to join, send an email to info@mayanyisroel.net or there's papers going around which have on them the to join the mailing list, then please do. Without further ado, Rabbi Katz.
Good evening, good Chodesh. It's very special to be sitting with this Chevra, Rosh Chodesh Sivan. Some old friends here, some new friends here. It's nice to walk into a building far away and see friends and smiling faces of people you know and love. I've heard really wonderful things about the shul, what Rav Igla is doing with the shul in the middle of Brooklyn. And here as well, but I haven't seen them yet. I'm glad they're probably sitting in the Ezra's Anashim at the back somewhere. I don't know where they've been placed. Sure they'll be marching shortly, that they need their own space at the cartel here or something like that, but it's a very serious time. It's a very serious, extraordinary opportunity. Shavuos is the day when we receive the Torah for the whole of the year, all the Torah that we understand, that we learn, that we feel, that we connect to. The Torah that we open up from the Sefer, the Torah that we see when we look into the world. Torah is more than just some words on a page. It's the essence of spiritual connection that's brought into the world. So our capacity to connect the higher self, the tachlis of the Bria, the purpose of our life, the purpose of our meaning, to have clarity, to see Hashem in everything. That is all given to us in 6 days. So the Svarim say, as we know, that kol ha'leich achahavash, everything goes after the first point. Everything that happens in Sivan, everything happens in a month, in the Chodesh, is mechadesh, is renewed, is begins, so to speak, is revealed. in its DNA and its peak capacity, its potential, multi-potential capacity, already from the first of the month, the rush, the head, just like everything goes in our actions, our deeds, our speech goes after what's in our mind. So to the rush, the beginning, the first point of the month has everything within it. So tonight, there's a lot we need to remind ourselves to be learning together. And there's many things we can do. We can talk about the chashivas of learning Torah, the chashivas of keeping Torah. But I thought we would take a different perspective, which is just as chashiv and which is just as important and beautiful and relevant, which is Jewish love and Jewish unity. As Vigla said so beautifully, so eloquently, so much so I'm basically done. There's nothing left I had to say. That was what I wanted to say. So we can just bench now. Shir Hama. That, V'yachan Sham Negedaha, when the Jews got to Sinai, V'yachan, they encamped in the singular, as everyone knows, the line that talks about the Jews arriving and standing before the mountain of Sinai a few days before the revelation. It says, and they encamped there, but the Hebrew term, and they encamped, is actually not the Hebrew word, and they encamped. It's the Hebrew word, and he encamped. And as Rashi, the main fundamental commentary on the Torah, says, why is a singular form? And it says, ki ish achad b'lev achad, like one person with one heart. And of course, the Torah speaks in history. The Torah explains to us, they arrive there in a sense of unity, of bonding, of connection. The Torah is also speaking in the language of avoda, of consciousness. And it's telling us about something much deeper. It's telling us about when we want to receive spiritual connection in our lives, when we want to receive spiritual revelation in our lives, we must enter to that place. We must enter to that desire. We must enter into that state of reception, ki'ish achad b'lev achad, in a state of oneness, of achdus, of unity. If you want a drink, and you hold up your glass, and the person can pour the drink, but the glass is broken, the glass is shattered, the glass has holes, the glass has parts of the cup missing, it's ridiculous. Who would ever do that? The water would just pour straight through the kli, the vessel, onto the floor. If you want to receive something extraordinary in 6 days that could change your life, could change the history, change the universe, then the secret is you have to do it through a consciousness of Jewish unity. You have to do it through the consciousness of love. Hashem yivarech es amo b'shalom. In B'Midbar Rabbah, the Midrash says, why do all our prayers, the Shemona Ezra, the Amidah, the 18 blessings we say as Jews 2-3 times a day, we end with a blessing for peace. We have the key blessing of peace within the Birkas Hamazon. Why do we always have to have the concept of peace? It's because only in a state of peace, remember, peace means shalom, but shalom comes the word shleimish, shleimut, which means only when you have all the elements together, only then do you have a vessel that can receive. So our sages teach us, Hashem yivarech es amo v'shalom. What does that mean? Hashem will bless his nation with peace. That's gavaldik, because we really need peace. Hashem knows. But the sages read it. No, read it again. Hashem yivarech es amo v'shalom. Hashem can only bless you when you have yourselves have created peace. You can only receive when you are in peace within yourself. You can only receive as a nation something beyond the capacity of every individual, when we as a whole are united. That's why the Arizal, we know, the eminent, one of the greatest, if not the greatest sage of the last 2,000 years after Rabbi Shimon, the Arizal of Kabbalah, he says, when a person goes to pray 3 times a day, we take 3 steps back, we take 3 steps forward, we're supposed to look around, we're supposed to makabel upon ourselves, receive, enter into the consciousness of Ahavta Elokecha Kamocha. I love every Jew in this room. There's a tzaddik I know in Jerusalem, a great man. And when he goes to pray, when he stands up from the Amid, he stands from the front of the shul and he's leading the service, everyone takes 3 steps back and forward, he takes 3 steps back and forward, and then if you don't pray, you're supposed to stop praying. I'm not giving you halakhic advice right now. But if it happens to be, you didn't pray, you just open your eyes and look what he does. He starts looking around the room at every single Jew in the room. And he commits to loving that Jew at that moment, and that Jew over there, and he says, oh, that Jew over there. And then he enters in a place where everybody's bonded and connected in consciousness. A minyan is not supposed to be a group of people that just happen to, you know, need a place to pray. It's supposed to be a combined consciousness, and through that we can all receive together. There's a tzaddik called Tzvi Meir Zilberberg in Yerushalayim, in Jerusalem. I heard from him, he says, God forbid, a Jew should ever speak another word, a negative word about another Jew, or a group of Jews, or a kahila group of Jews. He says, the secret is, he says that we know, the mystics teach us, that there are 600,000 letters in the Torah. That's what they say. And they say, we know that there's 600,000 root souls of Jews in the world. That means there's really 600,000 Jews and 600,000 letters. And each of them is corresponding. And what that means is that every single one of us is a complete Torah together. So he said an amazing idea. He says, if a person has a mitzvah to learn Torah, but we have a mitzvah to learn all aspects of Torah, Pshat, Remez, Drushad, the mystical, the practical, and everything in between. And he says, if a person ever speaks Lashon Hara, negative words, about another group of Jews, another approach of Jews, it doesn't mean you have to be every kind of Jew. It doesn't mean you have to accept, it doesn't mean you have to, you know, do everything. But if you don't see that they themselves have a greatness, he says, when you speak negativity about that group, you cut off your capacity to learn and receive that part of the Torah, which is equivalent to them. So through loving every kind of Jew, you open your soul's capacity to receive every kind of Torah. So you see, it's a key thing that we spend a few minutes tonight, a few moments tonight, discussing the mitzvah of loving other Jews, in order that we can strengthen ourselves together, strengthen our consciousness together, our das together, to be open to receive the growth, the change, the meaning, the power, the connection that it has given to us on Shavuos itself. Now, I'm always cautious that there's a few things I want to say. Some are practical tonight, some are very deep tonight. But I kind of think if I'm going to speak about Jewish love and Jewish unity, I kind of think it's kind of the most redundant subject in the world, because everyone already agrees with it. Hands up if you think Jewish unity is a good thing in the world. Okay, looks like we're finished early. It's a Chinese restaurant over there, I'll raise you. So, you know, what else is there? Add a little chizik, don't blow it. The truth is, as the Ramchal says at the beginning of Mesilas Yesharim, in accordance to how much we know something is true, we usually, the more it's obvious to you, the less you're likely to do it. It's what's called in the secular psychologist cognitive dissonance. I think there's no subject which has more cognitive dissonance, which means the fact that you know it's true does not really affect our actions. Jews don't like other Jews. Let's be honest. The Litvaks don't like the Hasidim don't like the Litvaks. None of them like the Sfaradim don't like them. All of them hate the Chabadniks, don't worry, we don't like them either. But as long as we agree on one thing, we agree that black kippers are better than white kippers, right? But the white kippers and black kippers, we don't like those, you know, those four posted kippers, what are those things about, right? At least we agree together the kippahs are better than no kippahs. But God forbid you don't wear a kippah, you're getting struck by lightning. We all know that's to be true. Everyone knows the story about the Jew that was, you know, on the desert island, shipwrecked on the desert island. He built for himself a hut, and he built for himself a shul, and they came and found him 10 years later, and they said, what's this? This is my house. He says, what's this? This is my shul I built. He says, what's over this? He says, it's another shul. He says, why do you need two shuls? He said, this is the shul I go to, this is the shul I don't go to. Shem Yerachem. Every yeshiva doesn't like the other yeshiva, every seminary doesn't like the other seminary. Of course, Neve is the best, because that's where I teach. Unless I teach at Shavim, and then I hate Neve, and then, you know, it's very seichotic, it's very, very, it's very... I bet right now in the synagogue, let's be honest, some of the girls, I bet there's people in this room where you dive in every day, I bet there's people you don't like, there's people you're not comfortable with. Just as an exercise. Everyone put up your hand right now like this. Just put up your hand like this. Now hold up one finger like this, a finger high. On the count of three, just to illustrate the point, I want you to point to the person you don't like. Let's do that now. One, two. But you had someone you could have pointed to, right? No, don't point at me. That's just rude, please. So it's funny because it's funny, but it's ridiculous. If you're going to talk about Jewish love, if you want to talk about actually approaching something in a real way, you have to not just talk about the thing. You have to talk about the thing that stops us from doing that. So the thing that stops from us from Avos Yisrael is a thing called Sinas Chinam, baseless hatred. Our sages say baseless hatred destroyed the base of Mikdash, the temple. Because the sages say every generation that does not rebuild the temple is equal to that they've destroyed it themselves. That means, the mystics say, that right now we don't have a temple, right now we don't have Mashiach, right now we don't have redemption. It's because right now we have baseless hatred. So imagine you can think that that person you don't like in the shul, that person you don't like in the room, that is the thing stopping the world from ending in the most beautiful, positive way right now. Imagine that were true even. So I have to tell you, baseless hatred doesn't really make sense to me. Sinas chinam. I have to tell you, I travel around the world a lot. I teach a lot of classes, a lot of shuls, a lot of synagogues, a lot of yeshivas, a lot of seminaries, all around the world. And I have to say, frankly, I've never ever seen baseless hatred. Our sages talk about baseless hatred. I've never ever seen baseless hatred means you don't like a Jew like for no reason. There's no reason, etc. So I have to say, I've never ever met a Jew that doesn't like a Jew for no reason. They always have tens and tens of reasons why they don't like other Jews. Because the nature of a person, the nature of psychology, the nature of consciousness is when you don't like someone, you start generating reasons to not like them. You start creating lists mentally in your mind. You start watching them so they can mess up. So you go, something else added to the list. Let's just take out that list now and write that down. Great. And now when I get really angry at them, I've got an extra, whole extra 10 minutes I can spend on this. This is wonderful. So what do our sages mean, baseless hatred? Nobody hates someone for no reason. And of course, you know that I'm joking, but only semi-joking. Baseless hatred doesn't mean you hate them for no reason. Baseless hatred means the reason that you think is a reason is not a reason. Baseless hatred means, in Sinas Chinam means, the reason that you think is another reason to hate those Jews is not a valid reason. No, but Rabbi, you don't understand what they did to me. You cannot hang around them. You can disagree with what they did. But to dismiss the individual, to dismiss the soul, to not find the compassion for the individual, doesn't mean you stand in the way of the bullet when they fire it, God forbid. Yeah, but if you know what they did at that synagogue over there, if you know what that guy did that took my car back this morning, if you know what he's like, the reason that you think is not a reason. That's what Sinas Chinam is. So tonight, I want to talk about the antidote to Sinas Chinam. This is a disease. It's a disease that's deeply embedded in our consciousness, and all we have to work out, Bezrat Hashem, the Baal HaTanya will help us with that. And if we can work through that and we can release some of that, we can understand that, understand where it begins within us, then maybe we can open up, find a little ava, a little connection, and from there we can receive something much greater with our lives. So, to understand how we get over Sinas Chinam, how we find Avos Yisrael, Rav Yisrael Salanter says, when a person is working on a certain problem they have, emotional problem, an aveva that they do, a midas rawas, negative desires within them, a person should learn all the halachas in the Torah on that subject. Makes sense, because the Torah teaches us that tzior gives us the image of what life should be like if in relationship to that thing. The Baal Shem Tov says on a deeper level, when you have a problem, a certain issue, let's say you have a problem with Sinas Chinam, hating other Jews, he says if you take the pasuk in the Torah, the line in the Torah that gives us that commandment, and you just say that line to yourself over and over again, that itself can help you transform the problem within you, just by saying the line from the Torah itself. So what is the line in the Torah that teaches us about loving other Jews? Does anyone know? V'ahavta l'reicha kamecha. Almost heard a man's voice in the women's section. Is everyone okay? Someone has a cold out there? Now, I just want to put that on the board. Thank you for the board. Now, no one can actually see the board, all those people over there. Did you guys sleep overnight for seats? You got the lucky seats. So I'm just going to write on the board just so I know what it looks like. It's going to be one of those nights. They won't know what that looks like? No, okay. Okay, it looks like this. It's going to go really well, the visual part of the class. There's no real difference to the rest of you, is there? Fine. So I can see that. Can you see that on video? Well, that's different to everyone else, so why should they be able to see it? Let's turn the board around. Great. It's a multimedia class. Excellent. Extremely cutting edge. You trying to see the board? That's where you came forward? Trust me, I voted. So, according to Pnimis of Torah, every single letter is a tzino, is a pipe, and there's an energy in the pipe, and by saying it, it enters down through Chachma, through Bina, into Das, into your consciousness. Well, let's just begin with the basics tonight. This line has within it the secret of Jewish love. Now, I just want to say, what we're going to see tonight, we're going to explore these three words over the next 2.5 hours together. Why is everyone laughing? And we are going to understand, you're going to see, Hashem is not dogmatic. When Hashem says, love your fellow Jew, like yourself, that's what the words mean. Va'ahavta, and you should love, lo'recha, your friend, kamoicha, like yourself. You're going to find there's some really wondrous things buried in these three words. Not only is there the commandment, love your fellow Jew like yourself, like Hashem's just saying, shut up and love them, but I don't, shut up and love them. So Hashem's not dogmatic in that sense. First, he tells us what to do, but you hidden in there, is in these three words, is buried within there the secret of why you can't. The secret of why you don't. Hashem says, I understand that it's hard. He's going to show you psychologically what, in those words, the problem that you have with it. And then is well buried in those three words is an unbelievable secret of what you could do to achieve that state within your consciousness, within your psychology. So it's not just a raw commandment, a dogmatic statement, shut up and do this. It's also a sensitive, compassionate revelation of why it's hard to do this and the most beautiful, sweetest possible advice of how you could turn your consciousness around to begin to do that. So that's what I want to do. So let's begin by breaking this down together. There's so many iPhones, I don't know what to do with myself. It was consider it an offering to the iPhone God. I appreciate the offerings. Should I be blessed with the powers you've bestowed upon me? That's a vote as well. We don't like that, right? Okay. So let's begin at the beginning. I'm going to spend a few minutes saying the boring chat, and then we'll get to the fun stuff. Let's understand the basic explanation, and then like a ladder, we'll unravel that, and we'll see something deeper and deeper. I have to begin by saying something I should have said at the beginning of the class. That the class is in the course of two different things tonight. I'm here in this country for a wonderful chasana. Some of us have a good friend, Benjamin, who's getting married on Sunday night. And anything we teach and anything we say which is of any value to anyone who affects our neshama, any kedusha we can draw down into the world through this, should be in the schus of Benjamin ben Yaakov Menachem and Dana bat Yitzchak, that they should have shalom bayis together. Amen. They should have a holy family together. They should have beautiful, healthy, holy kinderlach together. And every kind of brach and ruchnis and gashmis should Hashem should bestow upon them. And the Kala's mother is very sick, so in the schus of this class, we hold the man Shulamit Bat Chana, that she should have a refuah shalema mamash with all the other Yidden in Yisrael. They need a refuah shalema mamash. What does this mean? Let's look at the basic three words. And you should love your fellow Jew, your friend. It actually means specifically a Jew, like yourself. So if we were to dismantle, deconstruct these words, let's come to that, huh? Would you like my chair? Oh, you're in my chair. I'm sorry. Please. That's right. Let the girls stand. Okay. You still get the mitzvah, don't worry. If I have any say in it. Let's break down this word. I want to show you some really extraordinary things within this term, within this phrase. Basic explanation. What does it mean that you should love your Jewish brethren like yourself? Just the first question, the most obvious question glaring out is, what does it mean like yourself? You should love other Jews. Create Ahavas Yisrael, Achdus, unity. That's just a part to say. What does it mean like yourself? Hashem's obviously trying to reveal to us something in there. Many Jews feel they fulfill this every day. They say, I don't like other Jews, but I also don't like myself. Therefore, I fulfill the line of, you should love other Jews as much as you love yourself. Yahtzee. So if you look in the Ibn Ezra and the Sforno, they say something very, very simple. As much as you love yourself, as much good as you want for yourself, you should also want for somebody else. You get invited to your best friend's children's wedding, and you go a little late, and you leave a little early, and you know, it's very nice to dance, and the kugel's also nice, and there's lots of things nice. Can you find great simcha for the children as much as for yourself? You know, you're chalashing, you're confused, will your children get married? But you know your neighbor, your friend, and someone else in the synagogue, his children wants to get married. Can you extend yourself a little further to help them with the shidduch? As much as you want for yourself, as much as you would like someone to appreciate what you do in life, you feel unappreciated. Do you look around and appreciate other people? As much as you would like when you walk into a shul, someone to, you know, give you a seat, pull you over here, sit down. Do you offer someone else a seat? If you would look, if you would get out of our own small world, a rosh katan, a small mindedness, if you will, and begin to see that as much as good I want for myself, do I want that good for other people? Learn about other people by seeing your own needs, your own desires, and then share that with them. And you should love your neighbor like yourself. Use what you know about what you want, and as much as you want that for yourself, want that for someone else. Now, if Desla takes it a little further, in Michtab Mi'Eliyahu, he says something a little deeper. He says that the one love that we have in all of the world that is inherent, that is automatic, that is primary, is self-love. And the most fundamental thing we have as human beings is we look out for ourselves. We want the best for ourselves. We want our own happiness. Even people that chas v'chalila, lo aleinu, even people that commit suicide and kill themselves, look at the pain they want for themselves. No, no, no. If you speak to people in that state, if you speak to people that have survived that state, why do they kill themselves? Because they see that as the best option for their happiness. They may describe that as cessation of pain, cessation of their struggles. Therefore, they think it would be less painful, nicer, better, more fulfilling, more happy, more generating, more simple for them to be dead, so to speak. So it's the most natural state, default setting within our consciousness is to want the primary love, which is our self-love. Rav Dessler says something very interesting. He says, leverage that self-love to love other Jews. How is that possible? How can you do that? And he gives a very practical example. He says, give them a present. I'm sure you've all heard this before. This is just, we're going much deeper. We're just beginning on this. He says, give them a present. Now think what that means. I want everyone to think about someone in the room, someone that you know, which is not such a great relationship. And give them a present. You're welcome to use me right now as that example. I'll be passing around my hat. Give me a present. What a deep Torah that was. What a L'shem Shemayim lesson that was. I'll be taking presents in $50 bills. What does it mean, give them a present? He says, find out something that they need and give it to them. find out, does this person need a chair? Give them a chair. This person need a schnitzel? Give them a piece of schnitzel. This person need a drink? Give them a chair. This person's a shidduch. This person's a donation. Give them something. This person's down, cheer them up. This person needs some chizuk, gives them some chizuk. So what happens is when you walk down the street and you see that person, you don't really connect, you go, well, they're so miserable. But when you make them happy, then they walk away, you go, I made them happy. Well, that guy I don't really like, but when I found him that shidduch, you see the chasana, they're so happy. Yeah, I made that shidduch. Everybody knows that what you invest in, you ultimately see as an extension of yourself. If you've helped build this wonderful shul over the last 8-9 years, however long it's been here exactly, then when you see a lot of people here learning Torah, you go, yeah, look what we've done. Look how beautiful this. This is our rabbi. But look how beautiful his Torah is. Because you see that thing is me. Whatever you invest in, your football club, your baseball team, your car, your hair. Someone goes, you have beautiful hair. The guru goes, thank you. You have beautiful eyes. Thank you. What, you made your eyes? I've been working on them all morning. I guess in this generation, we probably do. You have a beautiful face. Thank you. I just got out of the hospital. It's the Torahs that used to work don't work today. Okay. You have beautiful hair. Thank you. It's because I work on my hair. I design my hair. I build my hair. I go to the hairdressers. I want it that color. I want the curls right there. And because what you invest in, you alter, for better or worse, you see is it's called the fluid self. It's called Das and Galus. We see ourselves in what we invest in. So that means when that person, you look after him, you give him some chizuk, you make him happy. You see, he's very happy today. Yes, because I helped him with that. So what you are doing, you're using your self-love and investing that in something else, an organization, a person, an individual, and you begin to see that their happiness is your happiness, their success is your success. Vedessa says, love flows in the direction of giving. Love flows in the direction of giving. Wherever you give to, that is where you will see yourself and that is what you will love. It's of course the secret, everyone's heard these things before, I'm not saying anything interesting yet, is that the root of the word Ahava, everyone knows, just writing on the board so I can see it. Everyone knows that the root of the word Ahava is the Hebrew word to have, is the Aramaic word have. Have. So it's interesting, because in English, the word have means to have, what I have. But Aramaic, a sister language, the word have actually means to give. What you have is what you give. But in English, have means what I'm trying to hold on to. A story that just drives this home for me. Is a friend of mine, Yeshiva, his brother made a quadrillion dollars. May not be a word to you, but it is my six-year-old child. He made an upstart. And he sold it to Google, a couple of nice Jewish boys as well, and he made a quadrillion dollars. And my friend in Yeshiva told me, he's a very sweet guy, very rich guy, And when the stock market crashed, however many moons ago that was, he lost like everything in one of those like 15-minute windows. And he told me that, my friend in Shiva told me, his brother was literally on the floor for like 2 days and they couldn't get him off the floor. He was just like collapsed and frozen. And a few months later, when we were talking about it, I was at a Shabbos table and the brother was there and was talking about it. And he said something, we were talking about the importance of tzedakah, and he said, the point of giving charity, he said something that's so profound, oh my gosh. He said, hindsight is 20/20. He said, I realized, I had millions of dollars. I could have retired, I could have had everything, but you want a bit more, and you invest a bit more, etc. He said, you realize, you know what, I gave, my brother called me up, he reminded me about, don't forget to give 10%. He said, I was a little greedy, I didn't want to give 10%. I gave a good amount of money to someone, a certain cause. He says, I realize today that the only money I have is the mitzvah that I did with the money that I had. He said, that mitzvah is forever mine, but the money itself was lost forever. So listen very carefully to these words. In English, what you have, I want to have it, I want to keep it, that you can lose. But what you give is what you have forever. And a little deeper, we all know that love is, what is love in general? That's a very deep discussion. I wasn't born religious. I'm zeichet to be a Baal Tshuva. And I remember when I was in high school, there was a girl that had a crush on me. I don't know why either, I'm just putting that out there. Because of my cool haircut, maybe. And it was a bit weird because I didn't feel the same way back, which was probably signs I was homosexual or something. How could it be that a girl would like you when you felt nothing in response? There must be something wrong with you. And she even wrote me a letter. She said, "I love you," which triggered this deep existential crisis. Because I'm not so attracted. What do you mean? She's a girl. Okay. So I didn't know what to do about that. So, you know, it's another time, a person's out there, they don't have a rav, they don't have Torah, they don't have anywhere to go. And I was like, what is love? And maybe I like her. Does that mean I love her? And how do I know if I'm in love? So I don't have anyone to go talk to, anyone to ask. So when you're in high school and you need some Eitzah, you need some Eitzah Tova, you need Hedroch, and you need advice, you need clarity, you need truth, who do you go to? You go to the cool guy in school. Because everyone knows the cool guy has deep wisdom, which has made him so cool, and he must have Bechinas Emes at least. So I had this gabbai after the minion, and when he drove in on his motorbike and his leather jacket. So I said to this guy, Timmy, I said, "Timmy, how do you know if you're in love? Listen to these pearls of wisdom." Write this down, this is very, very hush of stuff. And Timmy, the cool guy, he says to me, you know when you're with someone you just feel like so like together? And you're so eloquent, and you're so funny, and you're like, you're just like on it always, and you feel like you're the best person you can be. And I was like, yeah, I know that, because there's people I don't feel myself with, and sometimes you're with a person, and you feel like the best. He said, "That's love." And I was like, oh my gosh. And then he said, "Put on tefillin." I put on tefillin, it was amazing. Makav made a call. Not really. I was like, that's so incredibly, incredibly true, because I've had that happen, so it must be true. That's a raya. Now, I have to tell you, in case you don't know at all, that is the biggest load of garbage I've ever heard in my life. You don't love that other person, you love yourself. I feel cool, I feel intelligent, I feel bright. That person doesn't exist right now. It's like the line, everyone knows this line, right? Well, what's your favorite food? I love fish. How do you like fish? With the butter, with a lemon, a slice of it. You don't love fish, you love the tingling of the salt and the fishy taste on your taste buds. If you loved the fish, you would take it for walks on beaches, you know, on moonlit night. You'd tuck it into bed at night and read it a story. Take it under the chuppah. Coming soon to someone in America, I'm sure. Can we strike that from the video, do you mind? You don't love the fish, you love yourself. I feel great, I feel intelligent, I feel funny. And everyone laughs and goes, that's so obvious, I've heard that before. But Lamaisa people do it all the time. In Shidduchim, they do it all the time. You see, loving someone means to see someone. Loving someone means to know someone. In Hebrew, literally. And I just want to say, just on this point, before we get a little deeper, there's a very interesting thing, because if I can say this, I can never find the eloquent words to express this, but it's a very good idea in my head, I want you to know. That the saddest thing in the world is somebody that wants to be loved, and someone that just wants to be seen, and wants to be connected, and wants to. What is love? Love is a feeling of transcendence of self. Love is a feeling of bonding, uniting with something outside of myself. Love is a feeling that you ever go through life, you're just like you with your own junk in your head and your pains and your fears and that doubt and that thing you desire, that thing that happens to you. And we want to be loved. We want to feel that for once in our life, I am more than just me. I'm something bigger. When you love someone, you feel I'm expanding beyond myself. I'm seeing something beyond myself. I'm connecting and joining and bonding. with that thing. The saddest thing in the world, unfortunately, I know people like this, unfortunately I know marriages like this, is a person who's in marriage and alone. Because the marriage is constantly, I make demands of my partner. She has to be more like this, she has to look like this, she has to dress like this, she has to act like this, she has to have this look in her eyes, she has to have this in my house, she has to have this in her home. Now my husband needs to do like this, he has to act more like this, he has to treat me more like this, he has to be like this. And constantly it's, oh, I need what I need, what I need, what I need. And the incredible, extraordinary danger of that is that a person can have someone right in front of them but be so focused on themselves. Why do you want to be loved? Because I want that feeling of not having myself. But what you're actually doing through just reinforcing your needs is you're enforcing your identity of self. Love means to see someone else before you see yourself. To give to someone else before you give to yourself. Now I'm just saying basic stuff still. That's what everyone knows, the numerical value of the word ahava, everyone knows basic stuff, 13. 13 is numerical value of the word, echad, one, unity. And therefore the root of the word is to give. And through giving comes to unity, because giving means I don't act, I don't identify with the external separate element of myself. I go into the internal unified part of myself, and that's a discussion we're about to have, what that means in a practical psychological sense, you'll see in a very deep way. But when I don't act for my need, for my desire, I act for my das, from a deeper place within me. And I give beyond my desire. Then I join, then I bond, then I connect to something beyond myself. And then I begin to see something beyond my own needs. You could say about Rav Dessler, I have to leveicha kamocha. Through your self-love, you invest in someone else, and then you begin to look, oh, that, you know, that's what I did, I created that. But you could say that's so selfish, because in the end, in the day, you're still going, I made that show, I made that person, I helped that person. So still, you're just seeing yourself. So I think what Rav Dessler means there, he doesn't really mean that's the end of it, he means that's the beginning of it, because we go through our lives so self-absorbed, so caught in our own worlds, our needs, our fears, our desires, our pains, our lusts, our yearning, our ambition. That this is just a mechanism to lift our eyes out of the gutter, lift our eyes off of the street of ourself, and begin to see who is that person, what do they need? And then once you make eye contact, heart contact, then from then you begin to care, then you begin to see there's an identity, then you begin to listen, then you begin to notice, then you begin to witness. Love means being a witness. That's the word for intimate bonding. Intimate bonding between a man and woman is da'as. Adam knew Eve in a biblical sense. But it also is the word knowledge. And if you flip around the root of that word, dalet ayin, you get the word aid, to witness. Knowledge, witness, das. The Baal HaTanya says his kashrus, connection. Knowledge, to witness another person, these are all one in the same, to transcend the details, the pettiness of my own heart and see. Through the concept of love, through the concept of giving, I transcend my small world. I see someone before I see myself. I give to someone before I give to myself. I lift my eyes out of the gutter, and through that comes actus unity. Through that comes transcendence of myself, my small self. Think of someone right now that you don't quite connect to in the show. Think of someone in your own life you don't quite connect to. What could you actually do for them? Could you give them something? Do you know what they need? No. Isn't that itself a problem? How would you find out one thing you could do for them? Who would you have to talk to? Could you talk to them? Rabbi Katz said, I have to do an exercise with you and choose someone I don't like. I chose you. What do you need? Can't afford that. Next. Not doing that. Are you mad? Next. This is too hard. I hate learning Chassidus. Could you think of something? Could you try it? One, love flows in the direction of giving. Another example, very, very quickly. There's someone you don't like, that person you don't connect to. Write lists. Mm. write a list about their positive character traits. There's a famous story about a Rosh Yeshiva in Yerushalayim, who's no longer with us. And a bacha from his yeshiva was cleaning the house for Pesach and cleaning the Rosh Yeshiva study. And he was up on the chairs, dusting the top of the cupboard, and they found this old notebook and another notebook and another notebook, all these piles of notebooks. And the bacha didn't want to look inside. It's not his place to look. But coincidentally, it fell off the shelf, accidentally open in his hands. Go figure. And he looked down and he found it was very interesting. It was white pages and a single line of words, of adjectives down the page. He turned over the next one again and turned over the next one again through every single book. And what were the words? There were things like loving, caring, happy, compassionate, giving, nurturing, joyful, Yerushalayim, just like adjectives, page after page after page, book after book after book. He didn't want to ask the Rosh Yeshiva, what is this? What's it about? Where's your family? He was embarrassed. He just wanted to say that he saw it. So like a year and a half later, he's sitting by the Purim suit, anyone's drunk, so nobody really cares. So finally it comes up and he says, what was that? What was that? I was in your study and I found out. He said, and I saw these words, giving, loving, compassionate, intelligent, sensitive, nurturing. And the Rosh Yeshiva says, I don't know, I've never seen that before. He says, what do you mean? I said, what do you say? The Rosh Yeshiva says, I've never seen it before. I don't know what you're talking about. So it's the end of the course and the Rebbetzin gets up and leaves the room and the Rosh Yeshiva leans forward and says, I'll tell you what it was. He says, you know, I noticed that men have so many complaints about their wife. You guys, not you, I mean, all the other men in other shuls around Brooklyn, but not you. And women give everything they have for the husband, and the husband appreciates it, and like once a week I'll buy you flowers, now leave me alone kind of way. But he wanted to be constantly aware of the good, so he said he committed from the day he got married to write every day at the end of the day three positive things he noticed about his wife that day. And he said he's been doing it for the last 50 years. He says, besides Shabbos, of course, he's never missed a day. And I thought how deep that is, because I think the nature of a human being is that we list negativity. Do you ever hear that voice in your head listing negative things about people? You know what my mother did to me? You know what else she did to me? When I was 4, she did to me. Then I did this and this and this and this. That was when I was 4. Let's go to 4.5 now. And we had this, 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 and this. So the way that we can turn that around is choosing consciously to list positivity about a person. And it's amazing what it can do. A very, very fast story. I'm embarrassed to tell the story, but it hasn't stopped me in the past. I was at a conference in Jerusalem for a certain psychological tour, and there were a lot of educators and therapists there. It was a pact of men and women from all around Jerusalem, all around Israel. And they have done a mechitza because there's religious people, not religious people there. And I'm just glancing around, and then my head's spacing out in the middle of a long conference, and I look up early in the morning, and there's a woman there, a full woman in the crowd, and she looks at me and she goes, so I stoned her. That's the end of the story. Now let's move on with the class. It's the Jewish way. So I didn't know who she was. It was like, that's kind of weird. Why is she waving at me? It's that we did one of those things like, this one. And she looked a little familiar. Now, I teach a lot of people, a lot of Torah, and I meet a lot of people. And it's nice to know their names, nice to remember them, but sometimes you don't as much as you want to and you wish that you did. So all you can kind of do is go. Anyway, but, and then during later in the day, I was just getting some food or doing something else, and she walked up to me and she walked past me across the room and she went, hi. And like, I had no idea who she was. So I was like, hi. So, and she's like constantly, like she came over to me and she said something like, do you have some time to talk? There's something I really want to ask you about. I'm like thinking, who is this person? It's just, everything's good with you? It's like, yeah, and yourself? I don't really know who you are, right? And then she walked away, got distracted, and I'm trying to think who she is, and then suddenly I remember who she is. Now, I'm embarrassed to tell you this, I'm going to tell you this for multiple reasons, some of them I won't actually express, but the reason I remember who she was a little scary. It was a story that happened. When I first got married, Shana Rishon, everyone knows, is the most wonderful year of your life, until you get married, and then... whoever that girl was, we have a professional outside that's willing and ready to work with you right now. Do you want to pass her a tissue, whoever that was? Uh, You ever heard that line, falling in love is the best 2.5 days of your life? So it's hard, it really is hard. With good, healthy, psychological people who really care for each other and are good communicators and want to make work, it's hard. That's what it's for, it's about being hard. So a few months into our marriage, usually the first period, it got difficult. My wife, who I love dearly, and Baruch Hashem, we worked through things and we're incredibly strong today, Baruch Hashem. But it was hard, it was difficult. And we sat down, we said, I think we need some help. We both acknowledged that. And for sure she needed help because I'm a man and I'm perfect. So we talked about maybe going to professional. I said, I highly encouraged her to do so. I thought that would be very helpful for her to work through her junk so she could appreciate how perfect I am. So we recommended a good therapist, and I encouraged that she should go first. So she went, and she went for one session, it was very good. Another session, she came back feeling very positive, very energized, very, you know, validated some of her challenges in life, except for things she was obviously wrong about me, but all those other things were helpful for her. So finally, she was really went for a few months, it was very, very beneficial. And then she said in that delicate, sensitive way that a woman who has a little BNA saver knows how to say, you know, suggesting that it would really help her with some of her stuff if I could come along as well. And I was like, well, if it would help you with your stuff, then I'm happy to do that, because certainly. I don't know why you were laughing. So we went and saw this therapist. Now, this was a very interesting moment in our marriage. Things were very tense, unfortunately, between my wife and I at that time. And we went and saw this woman. So this woman's very interesting. And we sat on the couch together opposite her. And she said, hi. And I said, hi. And she said, where are you from? And I said, that place. She said, oh, okay. So she said, I know a lot about from your wife's perspective. I'd like to hear a little bit more about where you're coming from, how you understand things. So it was very nice. So I started speaking. And I was talking about how I see things. And I couldn't help but notice a couple of times when I was talking, I said one thing about my opinion, and she kind of went, oh. And I just kind of thought she coughed. But I was just like, it was this weird kind of, And then I said something else at one point about my wife. I was like, I love my wife very much, and I really appreciate it, but she just has this thing. And she rolled her eyes at me. And finally, after saying a certain thing, she stopped and she cut me off. And she said, that is such a man thing to say. And then she proceeded for like this 10-minute monologue. Now, I hope, but I think I'm joking when exaggerating. It's all me. It's all my wife, is not me. I'm usually sat there saying we both care for each other and we need help working it out. And she's found this 10-minute monologue about how men are, how egotistical they are, and I don't know how to listen. And I was just kind of in shock. And it was like almost funny. And I turned to my wife, and my wife is doing this. And she looked at me, and I looked at her. It's like, are we on like a television show? Is this like... And this woman had like this pain. And like 5 minutes into a monologue, I was holding myself back. I wanted to put my hand in my pocket and say, here's my card if you would like to talk about this. I also have a couch you could lie down on. I'm much cheaper than you, for sure. And my wife and I left that place, I want you to know, much closer than we'd ever been. You ever heard the psychological tool, unite against the common enemy? We were like, whatever we're going through, at least we don't have the issues she has with her husband. So we smiled our way through, and like she even called back 3 months later, she was talking to my wife about something, she said, can I speak to Rabbi Katz, is he there? And my wife walked up to me going, like with the phone like this, it's for you. I'm like, who is it? And she said, it's her. Satan's therapist. And I'm like, I'm busy. She said, doing what? I'm like, anything. Tell her I'm on the couch and I can't get to the phone. She's like, no, you talk to her. And I'm like, hello. And she started with like this 10-minute monologue. I want you to know that I did very professional procedure. And if you have any complaints, I'm like, okay, thank you very much. Is your husband there? Could you put him on the phone? But I just know what to do. So I'm at this conference, and this woman walks up to me. She goes, hi. And suddenly I go, oh my gosh, it's her. Run away. Yeah. So suddenly I got really busy with my phone ringing, even though you couldn't hear it, but trust me, it rang, and I had to make a conversation, and she came after me another time, and I had a student to speak to outside, really after that time, and but she kept chasing me all the day. She said, do you have a second to talk, because there's something I want to talk to you about, and she's going to go again, you don't appreciate the greatness of my psychological procedure and my respect for men, and I'm just like, I just don't want to, and like she's chasing me, and finally she says, there's something I really do need to speak to you about, and I'm like, oh my gosh, I said, yes, hi, how can I help you? All right, seatbelt, click. And she said to me, I want to talk about Nassim. I'm troubled by him. And I'm like, who's Nassim? She said, we're really upset about him. He's such a sweet guy, and he's the most beautiful neshama, and we really have to help him. And I'm going, who the heck is she talking about? Who's she talking about? But I'm like, oh, great, Nassim, great. What are your feelings on it? Oh, well, I think he's also a great guy. I don't even know what she's talking about. And she said, he's been dating for so long and he can't find the right person. And I'm sitting there and I'm listening to what she's saying. And she goes, you know, it's also an issue with Bradley as well. And I'm going, Bradley, what? What is going on here? How does she know Bradley? Who is Bradley? And why does she care? And why is she asking me about Nassim and Bradley? And I don't know what's going to happen. And I'm listening to her talk. And as she's talking, I suddenly realize she's talking about these people. And she's talking about trying to help these people. And she starts telling me a long story about how she tried to find a shidduch for Nassim, a shidduch for Bradley. And that they weren't appreciated and she wanted to help them. And it was so beautiful. I couldn't help but being really moved by how compassionate this woman was. She was really going out to help two Yidden that were having problems, apparently in Shidduchim, apparently. And that I don't know why she was thought I needed, but she was really going to the nth degree when no one else was taking responsibility. She was trying to help them out. And I was really, really moved by what she was saying. And of course, when she did that, I started thinking to my own self in my own head, you know, look how caring this is. Look how sensitive she is. And of course, then you rewind, you start going, why were we so aggressive about it? Why were we so upset by that? That was probably wasn't professional what she did, but she's probably carrying her own pain, right? She's probably got her own issues, right? She probably has her own issues from her marriage. We didn't have to puzzle her. We didn't have to write her off. And I start going, look at this woman. She cares. She's trying to make a difference. Okay, maybe she had a bad day. She certainly helped other people. And she did help my wife at the beginning. And she did give her some chizuk and that kind of stuff. So as I was sitting there listening, I started to feel embarrassed, and I started to feel, she's okay, she's okay, she's okay. And then she said, you know, Bradley, she said, but finally now, Bradley's now married to Kate. And I'm going, and I'm listening to that, I'm suddenly going, wow, what a wonderful woman you are, how amazing you are. And I started going, kolo kavod for you. And she said, Bradley married to Kate. And I'm like, Bradley's married to Kate. And they went, oh, and I suddenly realized I have a friend called Bradley who got married to Kate. And suddenly I go, oh, Nassim Goldberg. And she goes, what? And suddenly the penny dropped. This wasn't that therapist. This was the Rebbetzin of my rabbi from my previous yeshiva. This wasn't that therapist at all. And I looked at her and I went, oh! Oh, oh, oh! Nassim, Bradley Kate! Oh! Rebbetzin, Mrs. Smith Goldberger, what is Goldstein, whatever she was. And she's looking at me like, are you okay? And I'm like, oh, you're not the evil therapist. Ah. No wonder you're so nice. What is very profound is that night when I went home, I realized that I did some very serious damage to the clippers in my mind at that day, because I realized that when I went home, having gone and thought for 2 minutes about that original therapist, about maybe she was compassionate, maybe she was trying, maybe she was attempting to do good, maybe something triggered it, or I've never got triggered as a rabbi, as a professional, whatever. My mind had actually shifted about her. I actually didn't feel angry to hate, and I spoke to my wife and said, I think that I was just rude about that. I think I could have been nice, and I think she could have helped us in the Baruch Hashem, we don't need that now. And I think the second kind of love is actually the real love that a Jew is supposed to have to another Jew. The love we're supposed to have between each of us in this room tonight is not the Jew not the love that takes lists. It's not the love that takes investment. Of course, we have to do that. We'll talk about why we need that. But the true love is complete. It's absolute. It's altruistic. It's consistent. It's overwhelming. How do you teach a Jew to love another Jew? It really takes lists. It's there already. It's a love that does not have to be built. It's a love that has to be revealed. I spend some of my days working in Kiev, whatever that word means, the K word. How do you teach a Jew to believe in God? See, if Chabad can't teach you this lesson, then no one can. Do they need proofs? Do they need lists? Every Jew automatically believes in Hashem. You just have to reveal that. How do you teach a person to have self-esteem? Write lists. Here are the valuable things I've done. Implication. I graduated from college. I have to believe in myself. Implication. If I did not graduate from college, then I have no reason to believe in myself. Every person automatically loves himself, but the fears and the doubts and the clippers, all the externality of their desires, that blocks them from their inner love. That's the secret of emunah. There's an aspect of love. The true love of another Jew is inherent, is absolute, is complete. It doesn't need to be built. It doesn't need to be trained. It needs to be revealed. That's the secret I want to teach you tonight. I'm going to show you that on the inside in a very deep way. I'm going to give you a very practical example of how that works. Chapter 32 in the Sefer Tanya. For the sake of time, we're running very late, and I want to teach you something I've found now. Everyone knows that the extraordinary secret is of Avos Yisrael is buried in chapter 32, Lamed, Beis, Lev. And this is what it says. I'm going to read it. I can read it in Hebrew just to show off that I can actually read Hebrew. For the sake of the audience, I'll read it in Aramaic, just to show you I can do that too. I'll read it. Nikru Kol Yisrael Achim Mamash, in English, just for the sake of time. All the Jewish people are called brothers, family, brothers and sisters, united mamish. According, listen to me carefully to these words, Mitzad Sharash Nafsham Behashem Echad. According, we are one, but we're not actually one. You're a bunch of people I never met before. We're all over the room in different places. We are one according to the roots of our souls within us, that are buried, that are one, that are united with Hashem as well. It's only our bodies that separate them. Rabbi Vigler was discussing this early in the night. He's probably learned Tanya before, yes, Rabbi? Yeah, class in the morning, probably. Listen to me carefully, I'm going to show you an unbelievable secret you haven't seen before here. They're called, all the Jewish people, brothers and sisters, family, one, right? Only according to their souls, which is united in Hashem. But their bodies, their gufim, their bodies separate them. And therefore, listen very carefully, it's a trick of consciousness. Loving another Jew is a trick of consciousness. V'lechein, ha'oisim gufam ikah, a person that sees their body, their externality, their desires, as the main part of who they are, their main identity, and their souls as tuffel, as secondary, as you know, I'll do something spiritual on Friday, but the rest of the week I'm not a spiritual being. It's impossible for them to have that deep inner love, ava va'achva, in a true way, in a meaningful way. Whether they're going to have a love that's dependent upon a thing, dependent if that person pleases me, etc. Therefore, listen very carefully. I'm going to show an unbelievable secret here in a second, if you bear with me as I build this up. The Dalai Tanya says, I know most of you read it before, some of you twice, is it says, the secret of Jewish love is if you see your body, your desires, or nefesh abahamas, as the main part of your consciousness, then you'll always see that person as separate, implication, and you'll have to write lists. And you'll have to invest yourself in them, etc., etc. But if you could shift in your own consciousness, your identity, then automatically and completely, like a parent loves their child, you would automatically completely love every Jew in a head over heels, beautiful, caring, nurturing love. What does that mean? So I'm going to take a few minutes to explain to you something very deep now. I'll do my best to make it as fast as possible, as clear as possible. But you're going to have to work with me to grasp this. I understand it's late. Hashem should help us. Here's a mashal I use to explain this. I'm not sure if you've been in Yerushalayim and Israel for Sukkot, for the festival of Sukkot, the festival of booths. Don't know what booths are. I think it's a word that Art Scroll created. It's like tefillin are called phylacteries. I'm going to put on my phylacteries and my booths this morning. So if you've been to Yerushalayim, it's the most beautiful festival. It's a festival in the street. Every Jew is there, out there, together, building their sukkahs. It's wonderful. And the area where I live, there's mamash like sukkahs on the street. When you walk home from shul, it's mamash like a maze you have to come through. So I'm sitting with my chevra, with my friends, with my students. We're sitting on a sukkah, and we love to sing, surprise. And we're singing in the sukkah. It's a wonderful thing. Now, it pains me, because we're sitting in the sukkah. It's wonderful, wonderful. Everyone's singing, and then there's like 10, 15 guys, and some beautiful harmonies. And what happens is I'm hearing all the other families and all the other sukkahs. Like, we're on the ground here, and there's another sukkah. I can hear right up there on the balcony. There's another sukkah over there on their balcony. There's another sukkah over there. So I'm hearing that they're singing and we're singing. Everyone's singing different songs. I'm like, why are Yidden singing different songs together? Wouldn't it be nice if we sang together? So sacrilege, but in the middle of a big crescendo, I bang on the table and go, shh, how could you kill a song? Chas v'chalila, stone him. And I go, back, I just do this. I just go, okay, yeah. I go, like this. And they're singing, and again, in that sukkah up there. We can't see them, but we can hear them. And I just start singing with them. And everyone goes, oh, we get it, we can do this. And they start singing too. So they're singing that sukkah, and we're singing our sukkah. And it's beautiful, and we're all singing together. Now, I'm not sure if they realize that we're singing with them. So when it gets to the end of the song, we start a new song to know if they'll come with, and suddenly they join in, they come with. So I'm like, oh, isn't this cute? So next, now we have to go to the next one, right? Right? Conquer, let's go. So a good Svarti cousins up there, they sing their weird Svarti nasally songs, which I couldn't sing with if I wanted to. But they sang one of those songs I know, which is probably Draw Your Car. It's the only one that all of us know. And they started singing whatever they were singing, but I didn't know this. So at the end of our song, we started singing the Svarti song, and then that group picked up and they started singing the Svarti song, and the Svarti song went over there, and then that group over there heard what was happening, so they started singing as well. So we actually had this beautiful singing between all the sukkahs. Now in my head, if this was a cartoon, I imagine all the sukkahs themselves are kind of dancing back and forward. And when we got out of the sukkahs, we all kind of looked at each other and smiled and said, ah, Now, it's a real thing. I'll ask you, this is a very deep question I'm going to ask you. Mamash, Kabbalah, Mamash, even a very deep thing. Why do we never do this before? How geschmack is it for Yidden that live so close to each other all year? And like, Lamaisa, we're sitting at our Shabbos tables each week. Why do we never sing together before? They're singing at their Shabbos table, I'm singing at my Shabbos table. Why do we never do this? It's so geschmack, it's so gewaldic. I've got 2 years of stories out of that one experience. Why do we never take that opportunity before? That's a very deep question. That goes to the depth of Kabbalah, depth of the structure of reality, depth of Chassidus. You're going, this is a very stupid question. But it's very, very deep. Why do we never sing before? The answer is because you can never hear them singing before. Because when they're in their house and you're in your house and they've got their big thick walls and they've got the corridors and they've got, you know, if you're in America, they've got the porch and the grass and then there's the fence and there's a swimming pool and the tennis court and the maid's quarters, right? And then there's another fence and there's the, right, et cetera, et cetera. When you're in your houses, you can't each other singing. When there's all that yeshus, when there's all that gashmius, when there's all that stuff, those bookshelves and those beautiful, you know, glass cabinets full of glass, beautiful, silvery things. The more when you're in your house with all that stuff, you can't hear somebody else singing, even though they're meters away, feet away. But it takes a festival of Sukkot, and it's not a coincidence, because Sukkot is in the schus of Aaron, who is Ohev Shalom and Rodev Shalom, right? And he's the Kohen Gadol, which means is the ultimate state of Anava, of taking away the Yeshus, the self, the ego, so to speak. And when you go into Sukkot, which means you separate from the Gashmius, the physicality, the Yesh, the material aspects, and you move into a place where the walls are thin, where the ceiling is open and transcendent, for the first time you can hear someone singing who is right next to you singing, but you can never hear them before. That is the secret of what the Baal HaTanya is saying, but I want to bring that all the way into your psychology and all the way into the pasuk, and you'll see something very, very profound. Are you ready? As fast as I can. There are four questions I want to explain to you now. Question number one, you ready? What does it mean there's an inherent love between Jews? That's what I said. Every Jew inherently loves each other. That's what the Baal HaTanya is saying. But didn't Rav Dessler say the only love is self-love, the only inherent love is self-love? Is that a contradiction? One. Two. Oh, I'm sorry. The first love is what does it mean, the hem love between Jews? Because I thought there's only a hem love between myself. That's the first question. The second question is, what does it mean there's a hem love between Jews? I don't feel it. Do you feel that automatically, head over heels all the time? Like it yourself? That's two. Three is, what do we mean? What are these walls? What's this gashmis? What's this yeshus? What's this ego that gets in the way? What are we talking about? Because the Baal HaTanya is not telling you a nice devar Torah in Chassidus. He's telling you about a trick in your consciousness. And if you chap it, in a moment you can turn your consciousness around and find incredible love. It's doable, it's achievable, you see. Four, how do I get that stuff out of the way? How do I do that and achieve that consciousness of true actus to take us into Shavuos in a way we can really feel that and connect to it? So I'm going to explain to you something very deep now as fast as I can. You still awake for something deep? Can you handle this?
No.
No?
Yes.
I can't either, I'm telling you. What do you think? I have the mega industrial size of caffeine. Could get in there as a sukkah. That's almost my size. Here's the deep stuff. Now, you can't see the board, so I can't put it on the board. It's going to be hard. You'll have to use your koyach hadimyon. Listen very carefully. This is deep. V'ahavta l'reicha kamoicha. If you look at the term v'ahavta l'reicha kamoicha, it means you should love your neighbor. It doesn't mean neighbor, it's not your shochein. You should love your friend like yourself. V'ahavta l'reicha kamoicha. Within that term, what is the Hebrew word for friend? Re'ya. So it looks like this. Reish ayin. Now if I asked you, what is the Hebrew word for friend? You would say, chaver. The more common term we constantly use is the term chaver. Now, re'ya also means friends, but it's a much less common term. So why does the pasuk say v'ahavta l'reicha kamoicha? And why does it not say v'ahavta l'chavereicha kamoicha? It's not a question, like it's not a kasha. It's just like obvious, it could have put two. Why does it use one term for friend and not the other term for friend? It uses re'ya, but it doesn't use the word chaver. So let's understand that, because there's an incredible conscious shifting secret buried within that. So I'm going to give you a puzzle now. I don't know if you write things out. I'd love to put this on the board, but you're not going to see it on the board. I'm going to give you a list of six different ideas, six random ideas. And I'm telling you, through the eyes of Panemius of Torah, there's somehow a connection, an association, a relationship between these six different random things. And I'm going to talk them out, and I want you to tell me, just in your mind, please don't yell this out if you've seen this before. I've also seen this before. I'm not going to yell it out. I want you to just think about these six things. Turn on the abstract chokhmah thinking cap and see if you can find the relationship between these six things. You ready? One, a shofar blow. Anyone write it down? A shofar blow. A shofar blow. Two is to break something. What's the relationship between a shofar blow and to break something? Wait, 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 don't yell it out. Remember that, don't yell it out part? That's okay. You're fired, get out. It's cold outside, stay here. The third one is a shepherd. What's the relationship between a shofar blow, a shepherd, and to break something? The fourth one is Hashem. The fifth one is, I don't want to get it heretical, but evil. And the sixth one is friend, a friend. Someone you love and care for. Now I want you to think, you've got a shofar blow, you've got a breaking something, you've got a shepherd, you've got a shame, you've got evil, you've got a friend. What's the connection? By the way, putting them all in a sentence does not make a connection. Once when my shofar broke, a shepherd told me about Hashem. I thought he was evil, but now he's my friend. And that's Pshat in the Tanya. Shiramas. If we had time, I would get you to think about that, because some people could probably get it. Hands up if you think you know what it is. Men, do you have a clue? You think you could get it? Think you could get it? So listen very carefully. Can I take this off? No. What's the Hebrew word for friend? We just said it's Reya, Reish, Ayin. Right. The Hebrew word for shofar blow, there's a number of them, but one of them is called teruah, which looks a lot like this, teruah. The root letters are Reish and Ayin. The word break in the beginning of Tehillim is tera'em b'shevet barzel. I will break or shatter something into pieces. The root is tera'em reish ayin. The word for shepherd is? Ro'eh, right? Also the root reish ayin. Hashem ro'i v'lo echsa. Hashem is my shepherd, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Why don't you want the Lord your shepherd? I don't understand. The Hebrew word for evil, ra, reish ayin. What do all these seemingly random terms have in common? They all have the root Reish Ayin, Reish Ayin, Reish Ayin, and Reish Ayin. Now there's an axiom, it's not for tonight's class, but the axiom I'm sure you all know, that the Hebrew letters always represent the DNA of the concept in reality, the source of the concept in reality. Therefore, if you have many, the mystics consider as an axiom, if you have many different ideas which have the same two or three Hebrew letter roots, it's an indicator that they're not really separate ideas, they're all the same idea expressed in different ways. So what is the relationship, what is the essence of all these six different ideas? I'm going to explain that to you right now. The secret is this, listen very carefully. A classic question. Why do we have any tzaras in the world at all? Problems in the world, challenges in our life at all? If Hashem is perfect, why did He make a world that wasn't perfect? And while that's a very complex question, I'll give you a complex, simple and yet true answer. Why did Hashem, is so perfect, make a world that wasn't perfect? The answer is He didn't. He made a perfect world. We broke it. Why do we have to suffer? Why do we go through pain? Why do we have challenges? Everything from the Holocaust to, you know, I break a little fingernail. Now, God forbid that they're comparable, but if God is perfect, why should that happen in the world? And the answer is because we are doing the tikkun for the chait of Adam and Chava. That's what the mystics say. Because all the suffering, all the challenges, all the pain in the world is got to do that we are somehow fixing. We are doing tshuva on the sin that they did. I'm not asking you to believe that, I'm just showing you a model, a system. That's how our sages describe that. Which begs the question, my friends. Why should we suffer? Why should we go through pain? Why should we have difficulty? Just because somebody else did something wrong. And the answer to that, which is the mystics take as an axiom to the structure of all of reality, it's discussed in Toma Devorah as a million other sfarim as well. Why should we suffer for what they did? The answer is because we are them. We are all Adam HaRishon. And the mystics say that when a person goes to do a sin, God forbid, chas v'chalila, and a person does any sin, from speaking lashon hara, chas v'chalila, to eating the wrong thing, chas v'chalila, to doing an action which is not good. This is how they said, there's many parts of your body that are involved with that. The mind that thinks it, the hand that reaches out to do that, the mouth that speaks those words. And when Adam committed the sin, there was such a heavy consequence that if he would have had the whole tshuva done on him, it would have torn him apart. So what Hashem did in His infinite compassion is with Him, Hashem broke down Adam into multiple component parts. Multiple separate pieces, and each one of those pieces, right? Each one of those details is a part of the soul of Adam, which is manifest within every single one of us. And every single one of us is going through the challenges that we're going through in life to try and attack and to align, to fix, to resurrect the broken pieces that Adam did then. So what we are, Adam is called a neshama klali, a unified singular whole, and we are broken off separate pieces of that. And the mystics say, we've all heard a term before, you've heard the term kibbutz galus. The ingathering of the exile. So most people think, you know, I always say a good business advice, if you're looking for a good business investment, you should invest in El Al. Because the end of day, as much as all the stocks will crash, all the Jews are going to get on the plane around the world and come home. Who else are they going to fly? They're going to all done tshuva, they need a kosher meal. So that's El Al for sure. Kibbutz Galus, we all come back to Yerushalayim, we build the base of Migdash, and we all finally learn the Tanya together, Baruch Hashem. Chabadniks say, you know, Mashiach now, and Baruch Hashem, they're right, and B'Shar Teva, we should be there already, B'mehev Yemeinu. And what happens is that, you know, the resurrection of the dead, and Moshe is there, and Avram, and Yitzchak, and Yaakov, and it's a wonderful Gavalik. But the mystics say, that's Kibbutz, everyone knows that's Kibbutz Galus, but the mystics say there's a deeper Kibbutz Galus. Listen very careful. Kibbutz Galus means the in-gathering of the exiles. The mystics say that when the world then shuts down, and the physical world as we know it no longer needs to be necessary, listen very carefully to this, that what Hashem is going to do, he's going to, like a jigsaw puzzle, take every single one of theirs and realign them and reconnect until we all become one back into one united being again. And your life and your experience and your history will suddenly bond and melt into mine and yours, and everything you went through and all your challenges will make sense, and we'll all come into one complete super consciousness. So what began as a whole got broken down into multiple pieces, resurrected, realigned, rejoined together to become one. Listen very carefully. The mystics say the following thing. The term Resh Ayin always means when a whole singular entity is broken down and fractured into separate elements. You see, this is the secret, v'ahavta l'reicha kamocha. Love your neighbor like yourself. Love the fellow Jew like yourself. Listen very carefully, my friends. Why do you have to love them like yourself? Because they are yourself. But you just can't see that right now. Resh Ayin means when the whole is broken down into separate pieces and elements and you can't see the connection of a state of purity, of separate, of difference. This is why the shofar is called a teruah. Listen very carefully. There's many different shofar sounds. First there's a tekiah, then there's teruah, then there's tekiah. First you have one singular whole, then we have teruah resh ayin, the breaking down into separate individual pieces, and then we have tekiah, it's all resurrected, united, bonded, and joined together. That's what it means to break, tera'ein b'shevet barzel, it says in Tehillim. Because it means to break and to shatter the whole into pieces. That's why evil, the word evil, and this is a whole class, is a whole discussion unto itself, the definition for evil means to break and to shatter. It means fragmentation, because what evil, what Ra causes in the world is disconnection, fragmentation from Hashem. Taiva mevachesh nifrad. A person that pursues their taiva, their desires, fragments themselves. You speak like in Holocaust, really, you disconnect between Jews. A person goes after their desires, even in certain desires that they pursue of taiva in the world. They fragment themselves psychologically. That's my secret. Nobody else can know who I am. No one else can tell me they did that. No one else can see that thing. And we break ourselves off into pieces. We get angry at Jews, angry with ourselves, etc. A shepherd. Why all the great leaders of the Jewish people, shepherds, it's not because they're all from New Zealand. The reason that they're all shepherds is because, you know, at the basic level is because Hashem says you want to take responsibility for my people. First take responsibility, show me you can take responsibility for something. David HaMelech killed a lion in a bed to save a sheep. He really loved it. Moshe Rabbeinu was zoicha to Mamish Navu on the highest level to see Hashem and talk with Hashem because he went to save one little sheep. Hashem says, now I see you care for the little individual detail. Now I'll give you a whole people to look after. But we know a shepherd is like a tzaddik. Every tzaddik is called a shepherd. It's because a tzaddik is a part of all the yin and all the separate bits of pieces. And a tzaddik unites all the pieces together. And he sees every yid, as Rabbi Vigler said before, every yid and their gift and their contribution, their uniqueness. And a tzaddik, a Rebbe, is able to see the connection between them all. He's able to see every single one, as the mystics with Nachman say, or the Svarim say, every single one is a note, is a contribution to make, and a song that we all have to sing together. And the job of the shepherd is to guide and build and unite all the separate pieces together. So Resh Ayin means the separate, the distinct, the we're not the same. But look at the word Chaver. What does Chaver mean? So everyone knows the word Chaver. Should give up on this board a long time ago. Chaver is the other Hebrew word. But interestingly enough, Chaver comes with a three-letter root, Ches, Beis, Resh, which actually means Chibor. It means joined and bonded connection. It means glued, united. So it's very, very interesting because the word Resh Ayin means fractured, distinction, separate, details. And the word Chaver, the other word for friend, means joined and bonded and united together. Which makes us ask the question, so what does Hashem want to tell us? Is our friend someone that we're unified and connected with? Or is our friend someone we're separate and distinct and divided from? What's the answer to that question? Both. What country is this? America, right? Thursday night, must be America. Can I just ask you a question?
Me?
Yes. Do you mind? No. I'm just interested. How wide is this piece of paper? Inches, let's see. How wide would you say it is? Yeah. Have a look at it.
11 by 9, probably.
No, but I want you to look at it right in front of you. So tell me, how wide do you think it is? Have a look. You can tell me how wide. Throw out a number, any number. If you know, you can say it.
Talking about the width.
Yeah, what you're saying, what you're staring at.
0.1 centimeter.
No, wow, that's the most abstract answer anyone's ever given.
It's very, very small.
Now, how wide?
Okay.
Yeah, it's easier, isn't it?
Right.
That's a good, that's okay, it's a fine 11 eye. Inches. 11 inches, great. What's your name? Gitty, correct. Good for you, Gitty. How wide is this piece of paper? No, you're staring at it. How wide is this piece of paper?
Well, I know that most of them are 8.5.
So how wide is it?
8.5.
8.5, great. So we have a machlokas between two yidden. One shita says it's 11, and one shita says it's 8.5. Which one's right?
Both.
What's the difference? Two different perspectives. When you see the same thing from two different perspectives, and we have the third perspective, which is this, which is a very weird answer, but that shows a deep, your own, you know, Weltanschauung way of seeing the world, which is also Kodesh Kedashim. Is your friend someone you are close to, or is your friend someone you are separate and distinct from? The answer is both. When you meet that yid, I don't know who you are, I don't know where you're from, I don't like you, I don't connect to you, because we're in a state of reya, reish ayin. But when you get to know that person, you bond with that person, you love that person, then you become a chava. That's they become your chevrusa, right? We're connected, we're joining and bonding together. Now listen very carefully. Who can answer this question? There's a mitzvah called v'hafta l'chavarecha kamoicha, right? No. There's a mitzvah called v'hafta l'reicha kamoicha. Why is the mitzvah you should love your reya kamoicha and not the mitzvah you should love l'chavarecha kamoicha? The answer is, when you tell Jews to love other Jews, everyone's answer instinctually is, yeah, I do love other Jews. I love that person over there, and I love my mother, and I love my wife, and I love those people. We all think that mitzvah is, love the Jews that you love. Okay, that's sure. Okay, but they're idiots. No, when you see how they wear their hats, they wear it down, but I wear mine up. So they're obviously off the derech, right? And I don't connect to her, and she, well, what's her problem? And she took my seat 15 years ago, so to this day, I will give a Kabbalistic curse every time I see her, right? So what happens is, listen very carefully, my friends. You see, the mitzvah is not love the yidden that you love. The mitzvah is to look at the person that you don't see as connection and to find the connection. That's why it's v'hafta l'reicha kamoicha. And that's what it means that all love is inherent love, because we're all really one, we're all really connected. The self-love is the cup. Now here's the question. So that's what we know. That's why we're connected. That's why we're one, united. But why don't we feel like that way? Say very, very fast. And we'll end on this deep point. And I'll give you a story, and we'll go home. Or I'll meet you in the Chinese restaurant next door. Why don't we feel that love? We have you love someone like yourself because they are yourself. We're all one, we're all unified. Why don't we feel that? Ahava is numerical value 13, which is one, because love, I love you because I see you in me because you are me and I am you. But why don't we feel that? So I'll give you a practical exercise. And then you'll see the godliness of what the Tanya is really saying. Incredible psychological insight. If that's what I have, what is that yesh? What is that ego that gets in the way? You know, if you're taking a hot drink to the kitchen, to the table, and you're walking out of the kitchen, and your hand accidentally opens up and the glass falls to the floor and breaks, does anyone like slap their other hand? You idiot, shut up, don't do that. Yeah, you want to do that? You want to go outside? No, yeah, I'll go outside with you. Outside. No one would ever do that. Because you see, down here, we're separate, right? But everyone knows though, if you just follow that back up to its source, you see, oh look, we're all one. That's what he's saying about consciousness. But it's just like the source is not so easy to see. The source is the inner world. What stops us from seeing that unity? Here's a little exercise for you. Now, I can't make you do this exercise. I can give you an opportunity to look into yourself. If you like that kind of stuff, you will. If you don't, I'll meet you back here in 2 minutes. Think of someone that you love more than anyone in the world. If you have a pen and paper, write down that name. I want you to choose one person that you love. When I say love, I don't mean Tom Cruise. I don't mean a big, famous, quote-unquote, person, whoever these people are. I mean someone in your life that you know and connect with, a friend, maybe someone you're married to, maybe someone in your family, someone on the shore, that you really adore, that you're excited to see. As the saying says, if you're going to be stranded on a desert island, that would be the good person to be stranded with. Think of that person. I want you to choose them very, very specifically. Don't go, yeah, I know someone like that. Tell me, in your mind, think who that person is. Hands up if you have that person. Okay, hands up if it's me. Why not? What did I do wrong? Because I went late, right? Fine, I'm not coming back anyway. Great, that's one. You've got that one? Great. I want you to now choose someone you don't like. And I don't mean Tom Cruise. I want you to choose someone you don't like, and listen very carefully, because this exercise won't work if you don't get this point right. When I say don't like, I don't mean someone that massacred a small community somewhere in the Middle East. I mean, listen very carefully, not somebody that did something terrible to you, God forbid. What I'm talking about is someone that you know is a decent person, you know they're probably okay, but it just being around them rubs you up the wrong way, whatever that phrase is. It triggers you, it annoys you, you just hate that person. I don't mean like because they did that thing to our community in 1974, that's not that kind of, I'm talking about someone that just, you know, frustrates the kishkas out of you. And I want you to, it could be someone in your family, it could be someone you're related to, it could be someone you're married to, Hashem should help, but it happens. It could be someone in the kahila, just someone that you're walking down the street, you'd much rather cross the road, so to speak. Or you live in the same house, but it's hard for you to deal with. Think that person, and just be clear on that person. Put up your hand when you have that person. Great, hand up if it's me. Just checking. Great, here's the next exercise. You ready? Next step, I'm going to show you what the Tanya means. It's very deep. Go back to the person that you love. Close your eyes for a second, if you like to close your eyes, or just think if you like to think. If you had to sum up in one word or two words or one phrase, what is it about that person that you really love? What is it about that person that you really connect to? If you had to be one word, they're so compassionate, they're so honest, they're so open, they're so crazy, they're so conservative, they're so simple, they're so broad. Try and find the word, resonate a word. What's the one? It could be two things, it has to be, it could be one phrase. What, they're so open, accepting, they're so straight and together. The discipline, the slight, whatever that word is for you, try and find, I'll be quiet for a few seconds, try and find what is that word that sums them up? The key feeling, that's why you love them, why you connect to them, that key thing about them that you adore. You'll probably find a word or a phrase that really does it. Hands up if you've got it. Hands up if you don't have it. Hands up if you lost your arms in the last 20 seconds and you can't vote on that. Okay, now this is the harder part, you ready? Think about the person you do not connect to, that rubs you the wrong way, that really frustrates you. What's that one thing that really ticks you off about them? She's so egotistical, she's so vain, she's so intelligent, she's so simple, she's so excited, she's so low-key. What's that one thing? She's so judgmental. She's so slack. What's the one thing, if you had to break it down to one word, one phrase, one feeling, that sums up what that thing is? Hands up if you got it. Okay, that was easy to find, right? Okay, listen very carefully. I know you can see this coming. Focus on the person that you love. Focus on that single trait you said is why you really love them. You ready? If you think about that trait for a second, and you reflect it back at yourself, Is that trait something which you also really love about yourself? It's one of your really strong points, or it's something you really wish you had? The trait of that other person, is that something which is also a strong trait within you that you have, that you're good at, or something you really wish you did? Hands up high if that is true. Up high. Most of the hands in the room. How did I know that? I just guessed. What a relief it turned out. The Baal Shem Tov says the whole world is a spiegel, the whole world is a mirror. What we see in others is really just an extension of what we see within ourselves. You see, you don't love that person. You love what they show of what you want of yourself. But of course, this is a door that swings both ways. As the Gemara says in Sanhedrin, and sorry, in Kedushin, Daf Ayin, Hakol HaPasol Memumo Pasol. If you have a problem with another Jew, not someone that did something awful to you, but God forbid, just that person you do, the reason you pasul, you write off that person, is because of something you don't like about yourself. Take that negative, that destructive, that trait that you don't like about that other person, and think about it for a second. Is that something you don't like about yourself? Is that something you're afraid of being yourself? Or is it something you've experienced, like that person's egotistical, but your father was egotistical and your father was awful, so that awakens a fear, a doubt, a pain from something else in your life previously? Most of you will find that that is. Most of you will find that's true. Hands up if that rings true for you. Let's see those hands now. Wow, that's a lot of hands. That's interesting because some people that doesn't work for them. I say, Rabbi, that doesn't work. When I was teaching this class at Neve, a girl came up to me, a very intelligent Russian girl, and she said to me, you know, Rabbi, that exercise didn't work. I was like, okay, it's not an absolute rule. There can be other exceptions. She said, after the whole class, that was the whole build-up. It didn't make any sense. So she was walking out of the room, and I just said to her, you know, I said, Jen, but by the way, what was the thing that you didn't like about that other person? She said, well, she's really stupid. And the truth is, this girl is exceptionally bright, exceptionally smart. So it really didn't work for her. So I said, I hear. Okay, what can you do? And she started walking off a little. And I said, by the way, Jen, when you say stupid, you mean like intellectually dumb? And she said, no, she's quite bright as well. But, you know, she has to make things in her life that she actually has to do. But she never learns the lesson. And she always, like, hurts herself because of it. And when she said that, she burst into tears and then just ran off down the corridor. The problem is that we don't realize that thing. You may not recognize that thing because you don't recognize it within yourself. Listen very carefully. Hakol apasol memumo pasol. The reason you love someone because you see at the moment an extension within yourself. The reason you hate them is because they're somehow reflecting something that someone else did to you. There's something you don't like about yourself, something you're frustrated within yourself. And therefore, the Baal HaTanya is saying, listen very carefully, that if you see yourself as a body, if you identify more with your fears, with your anger, with your hate, with your self-resentment, with all that kind of thing, your desires, when you look at that person, you will only see a mirror. But let's go over the advice here, my friends. Listen very carefully. If a person finds out the reason they don't like that other person in the shul is because that person has that character trait that they don't like within themselves, what would be the best way that they could learn to love that other person? They would have to love that trait within themselves. Do you hear that? They would have to accept that negativity within themselves. That doesn't mean I want to have negativity. It just means, okay, I'm dealing with it. I'm in a process. Like, hey, I wish I wasn't as egotistical, but okay, I don't hate myself for it. I realize it's not really me. It's a mirror that I'm here to attack and to work on, to elevate and fix. I'm in a process. I accept it. So watch very carefully the secret in the words. You ready? V'ahavta l'reicha kamecha. And you should love your friend like yourself. But I don't. Because he's such on an ego trip the whole time. Oh, but that's happening within myself because I hate my own ego or I hate my own issues. So what would be the secret to loving that person? If I could love that, accept that as my challenge, as my ticket in this life, right? It doesn't mean I accept it forever. I want to be egotistical, God forbid. But what it means is that I'm willing to accept that for now as part of a process and not hate myself. Listen very carefully. If you look at the Hebrew word v'ahavta l'reicha kamecha, the root of the word reya doesn't just mean friend. It also is the word evil, negativity. So if I want to love that other person, the secret to doing that is what? If I would v'ahavta l'reicha kamecha, and you should love your own negativity. and accept it as part of yourself. And if you would accept yourself as who you are with your challenges and not resent yourself and not resent your pains, then automatically that shift would come in consciousness and you could learn to love the person, accept them by yourself. We do a whole seminar where we teach people how to do that, and it's amazing that people they've hated all their lives, when they realize it's because of their own pain that they're carrying, they release that. In a second, that love is there. In a second, that love is automatic. It's completely, it's overwhelming, it's good. That's what the Balatanya says. If you get past your yeshus, if you don't identify with your own fears and self-hate and self-loathing, then automatically you will love every Jew. And through that, you'll see the godliness and goodliness, the spark within them. Through that, you will love God. That's why we all know that the numerical value of the whole line, you should love your friend because I am Hashem, is the same numerical value. I think it's 947 or 74, as you should love Hashem, your God. The mitzvah of loving your friend, of seeing through the chetzonis, the externality to the panemius, to the holiness, is exactly how we love Hashem, seeing through the chetzonis, externality of the world, and seeing God within it. And we can only begin to see God in the world when we can begin to see God, as the Baal HaTanya would teach us, as the Baal Shem Tov would teach us, by seeing through all the pains and fears and doubts we carry within us, to see the inherent good within us beyond that. I'd like to end with a story. There's always room for dessert. There's always a couple minutes of energy for a story, B'ezrat Hashem. I told you about a challenging time with my wife. I'll end with a beautiful moment in my life. I went out with my wife a number of times. I wasn't sure she was the one, and then I felt she was the one. And even today, when I realized that she was the one before she realized I was the one, I had that clarity. Even today, when she says, I love you, I always respond, I loved you first. She says, what's your point? I say, nothing. And I always remember the moment I really fell in love with her. We were dating a few times, and she's a writer. She's a really wonderful writer. She has some writing online. I always remember, like, she gave me something to read, a kind of diary about her life that she'd authored and published. And I remember I was, like, in the room reading, and I read this story I'm going to read to you now. And I just started crying. I was like this woman, I felt that I, for the first time, heard her. I heard her soul. I heard something deeper singing beyond my own needs. I got beyond my own, what I want for my wife, what don't I want for my life, what I have, and I heard her inner voice, her inner soul. I got beyond myself, I transcended myself into saw someone else. And I just want to read you the story that she wrote. Baruch Hashem, I was zeichet to also marry Baal Tshuva. And she wrote the story. I'm going to tell you what the story is briefly, I'll read the end, and then we're done, we're yati together. She said the story. She once, on her journey to search for truth, on a journey to search for meaning, you didn't end up in the strangest places. And she attended, when she was only 19 years old, a weekend workshop for women and voice and discovering their inner voice, their inner self. And it was led by these two women. One was a famous feminist author, and one was, you know, a person who had this freeing vocal method that they taught in the kind of theatrical circles. And they went away for this retreat, and there's like 40 women, like no Jews there. My wife's the only Jew there, as far as she knows. And the big finale, one of the exercises they did, that all the women, these 40 women, they sat in a circle together. And everyone was told that everyone has to do the following thing. They're going to stand up, they're going to go around the circle, and everyone has to choose four of the most significant moments of their life. And four of the most, and they have to enact them with four unusual ways. Like one, you're going to move to four parts of the circle, and the first part of the circle, you have to tell the first moment of your life by using only six words, that kind of thing. And the second part of the circle, you have to tell another part of your life and by singing a song, a famous song that everyone's going to know that sums up the emotions they're feeling. It's like that kind of thing. And they said that if people know the song, people are welcome to sing along with that person, but they should just let her sing the song by herself, then everyone will join in that song. And they had all these kind of avodas like that. So my wife said it was a really long day. It took them like a whole day to do that thing. And each person went around and they said, this is the six things. And each person had the song and the person would start singing. It was like some popular song that everyone in the group would go, oh, we know that song as well. And everyone would sing. It was a very nice thing. Everyone was singing together, using their voice together. So listen very carefully to this story. Because if ever there's an image of galus, of exile, I think this sums it up more than any story I've ever heard in a profound way. At the end of the day, my wife went at the beginning. She did it. She was Yahtzee. She sat down, and it goes on and on and on. And every time that someone sings, everyone joins in. It's very moving. There's only so much, you know, hours you can watch that for, do that for. So my wife says, at the end of the day, she's sitting there, she's not even watching anymore. This girl stands up, who's very kind of dark-haired looking, and, you know. And she stands up, and the girl starts doing her six words, and she does that. And then she gets to the spot, and she starts singing a song. My wife is not even paying attention because she's feeling hungry, she's feeling tired, she's not even paying attention. But the first attention she pays is she hears, you know, some kind of singing, some kind of guttural sounds. She realizes it's some kind of foreign language. My wife doesn't even know what it is. And the first thing she notices, because she hears that the people next to her, the two girls, they're kind of giggling at the song. And my wife looks up and notices, and she realizes some people are laughing, some people are giggling, and she realizes that this girl's been singing, but it's such a weird song that she's singing. Nobody knows that song, and everyone's kind of laughing at her, and like, she's a bit alone, it's embarrassing, because nobody knows that song. And my wife's kind of like feeling, oh, poor girl, it's a bit sad. And my wife tunes in, and she suddenly goes, wow, it's so familiar. What is that song? And my wife tunes into the words, and they're not at all English, and she sees that the girls are laughing at her, because she's singing some stupid, strange, foreign song. Some strange foreign girl. And my wife listened in, and she tuned into some of the words, some of which she'd heard before, and it kind of goes like this. Adonai Lam Hashem Alach B'terem Kol Yetzir Nivra. And my wife realized, I know that song. Something about Sunday school, you know, 10 years earlier. Something about something she maybe heard in a shul one time when she went there growing up. And then suddenly she looked around and she realized that, wait, she knows this tune. And she looked around and realized that of all the people in the room, nobody else knew. Everyone was laughing. What is this stupid lyrics? What is this stupid thing? But she felt this song echoing in her bones, in her blood, through a whole of her being. I'm going to read you what my wife wrote from her own writing. I glance around quickly. I have known this prayer for as long as I can remember, but no one else's face shows the slightest flicker of recognition. The Hebrew syllables sound comforting and familiar. The woman keeps singing alone. I am the only one who knows how to join her. Tentatively, I grasp a fragment of the new melody and try to attach the words to it. My voice, quietly at first, reaches out to meet hers. The woman hears that she is no longer alone. My wife described it, the woman suddenly began trembling. She, you know, she was so embarrassed. She was dying of embarrassment. She was singing it loud, and she heard a voice singing. The woman started turning around the room. Where, who knows my song? Who knows my song? Her eyes quickly scanned the audience, trying to find the source of the new voice. At the same time that I feel nearby participants turn to face me, astonished that another person among them can match these guttural foreign sounds. I am oblivious to their stares. I am singing only for this woman, towards this woman, to whom I suddenly feel an unbelievable deep connection. I know the meaning of her singing, even though I do not know the words of the song. When our eyes meet, the look we share is so intense that time stops. I see her relief and profound gratitude at having been saved from the nakedness of singing alone to dozens of uncomprehending faces. But beyond that, we recognize each other as sharing something that no one else in the room has. She does not need to tell me her story. I already know her story, just as she knows mine. I know you, we sing, through the Hebrew words, eyes riveted on each other. I know what you mean. She smiles at me warmly, and we are lifted, ever so briefly, out of the room. If ever there's an image of the Jewish exile, of Jews caught in their own world, not listening to each other's song, that someone right there with a cosmic neshama singing, but no one else can afford to hear, to be able to lift ourselves up from the ground, from the dirt, from the tide, from the hunger of the amal and toil of our daily life, to hear somebody else sound singing, God singing, neshama singing, to be able to begin to sing together, to take down the chitzonius, the walls, the yesh, the ego, that's really the only thing stopping me from loving a fellow yid. To live in that sukkah of consciousness every day of our life. We know that Yisrael literally comes from the word Yasha Kael. We will sing the song of God. The word Yisrael is Shah Kael, the song of God. The ability to hear God in this world is come from the Avodah, the Balatanya is teaching us, to push down our fears and doubts, to wipe them aside, to see the Tipanimis, the depth, the Nigun, the note of Torah, the song of Torah that every Jew can sing. And when we can do that, we can begin to sing together, we can begin to love each other, and then we are united, we are clear, we are joined, and we are bonded. The sound of the shofar rings out from every one of us. That's the sound of Mashiach coming, that's the sound of the base of Mikdash being built. That's the sign when Hashem's upper world can come down and be megala, be revealed through our lower world, because we finally said, as the Baal HaTanya is teaching us, to see the neshama is the ikka, to see your fears and your doubts, love them, accept them. It doesn't mean don't grow. Of course we should grow and build and change, but don't hate yourself, because every one of those fears and dies, there's elokus, there's an etzitzus of godliness within us. And we should be zoka to see that within ourselves. Through that we'll open our eyes and see that within other yidin, we'll sing together, we'll dance together, the building of the base of Mikdash, b'mheru v'yameinu, mamish, amen. Thank you.